All right, Griffin, our man, how are we doing tonight?
Good, how are you?
Man, absolutely blessed. We love talking baseball. We love getting studs in here. Tennessee, got a huge audience, and they requested you, man. We give the people what they want. So, Griffin, we're gonna give them everything about you, start to finish. But first, we're gonna break the ice a little bit, and this is where we judge you, man. And so, if these answers are terrible, we'll cut this episode early. I'm just,
Yeah, I'm a little nervous.
Yeah, so I mean, right out the gate, we got to know who's your favorite musician or band?
Oh, right now, probably Morgan Wallen. He just
Oh,
dropped that new album.
it's
I've been,
over.
I just got cut out already.
No, actually, Morgan Wallen's not bad. The reason we laugh about that one is that is the answer 9 out of every 10 right now.
Hey, I guess when
He's
you're on top right
he's doing
now.
his thing, right? Like,
He
can't deny
did just
that.
put out an album that was like 36 songs of the same thing, but hey, it's I still listen to it, so
If there's another,
36 songs.
but
Yeah,
Daniel,
it's like a massive, massive album. And I mean, every song's the same, just the same thing, but hey, I still listen to it, so.
if there's another reason that our other host should be here, he posted after listening to it that it was like the have to have album. So you and him would have been able to have that. Y'all got Tennessee in common. Now y'all got Morgan Wallen in common. Me and Daniel, we're from Memphis. We gangster. We listen to rap music. We're a
I mean, this is it right here.
That's
This is
not the
one of
new
them.
album.
That's
That's
a
older.
different album. It's a good song though.
I mean, it's okay.
No, it's good. That's a good song.
Maybe I just
But
need
that's
to.
an older. That's actually one of his top jams, though.
Yeah, I mean,
Yeah, that's a good one.
it's got 350 million plays. I mean, that's
I told you, I'm not the only guy that likes
yeah,
it.
he's not
Clearly
the
not.
one lone listener. All right, so this one got changed a little bit because I seen the Oakland A's doing this. We usually ask what your favorite movie is, but they were asking the MLB players what their favorite Disney movie is, and I think that's a fun question to ask adult men. So I asked you, Griffin, what's your favorite Disney movie?
Favorite Disney movie, man. Like, are we talking like animated movies? Because I think like
Any
Pirates,
of them.
I don't
Yeah,
know,
Pirates of
Pirates
the
of the
Caribbean is
Caribbean's
absolutely Disney.
under the Disney. But me and my brother, like, we'll go through spurts. Like, even over Christmas break, we'll just watch that whole trilogy or whatever. I think there might be more than three. But yeah, I've watched those growing up and still love them. I used to like watch them before I went on vacation. We'd go down to Florida in the ocean, make me when I was little feel like I was doing something I'm not. But yeah, probably Pirates of the Caribbean.
That is a solid choice, and I will drop news for anybody listening because I've never had an opportunity to do this. Daniel, I don't know if you've learned this in your time at Disney. Pirates of the Caribbean movies is one of five rides at Disney that the ride was created before the movie. The movie was created off the ride. So now you got something just random that you could throw at people that you know
Yeah,
now.
hey, I didn't know that, but I'm gonna store that up here.
But now let's get to
No.
what really matters. Oh, go ahead, Daniel.
Still waiting on that Tron ride to come out. That's been
Have you rode Guardians of the Galaxy yet though?
No.
Things banging. Daniel, you?
No.
Oh, that thing's where it's at. All right, but let's get down to what really matters. I gotta know your favorite baseball movie.
Probably Field of Dreams, no doubt. Just classic. And I think what the MLB is doing now with the whole Field of Dreams like rendering that they do in July, it's just pretty cool.
Yeah, especially that first one with the Chicago White Sox walking it off. That
Yeah,
was an
with like
ass
the and
whooping.
how that game went, it was like, man, it was really like a scripted movie.
So with that, who was your favorite athlete growing up?
Probably Ken Griffey Jr., no doubt. That's who I'm named after. My dad played with Griffey on Midland right before he was drafted number one overall, and I guess left an impression on my dad. And him and my dad were pretty close. And yeah, no doubt, definitely it being a Cincinnati fan in general of all Cincinnati sports, watching him when he was on the Reds was pretty cool. And then after he retired, probably Votto as somebody that I thought was always. A good guy to model your game after, just because he was all—I mean, he still is. Dude's like always adjusting, right? He's never like stuck in his way of what made him successful. He's always adjusting, and especially as he's aged, it's been pretty cool.
Yeah, I mean, obviously when you throw names like Griffey out there, like, you know, you're going to get people's attention. But when you throw Joey Votto out there, I think, you know, as far as like here as of late, like the guy, like you got to respect that name now. I mean, he's a trusted bet. Like he gets it done. I don't think he does anything like super sexy, like, but he just plays the game the right way. You know, at the end of the season, he's always right there, you know, up with some of the best. So,
yeah, I mean, every year, and I know he wants to win. And Cincinnati, I mean, the Reds in general, I mean, right now are, you know, going through some pains, and small market baseball in general is going through some pain. So, but to see, like, you know, your guy that was your NL MVP, it was your, you know, really only your big contract sign because it's the only guy you can afford, it stick around and still kind of be, I mean, not kind of, he's passionate about winning and saying, you know, and then before he retires, you'd like to, you know, try to turn the program around or the franchise around for the better.
Yeah, absolutely. It's tough as a small market team. I mean, even like where I'm from, the Rays, I mean, even those guys, every year it's a constant do more with less.
Yeah, I mean, just the resources, and the Rays have been pretty good at it as of late. But, you know, it's a tough game. It's a tough business. And I mean, Major League Baseball is not like most professional sports. I don't think people realize that with, you know, tax caps and payroll caps, and how, you know, the NFL is probably more balanced competitively because of that. Baseball, I mean, it's large market and everybody else, so it's tough.
Yeah, we'll get back into a little bit of the pro stuff, you know, towards the end. But I want to jump into the interview and start with your story. Obviously, we got to go all the way back, you know, to the beginning. So tell me a little bit about your hometown and where you're from.
Yeah, I was born and raised in Cincinnati, Ohio. Actually, a little suburb of Cincinnati called White Oak. Lived there, you know, pretty much my whole life. Actually, when I was real young, my parents moved. I'm the oldest, so it was just me and my parents, and we moved out to Brookville, Indiana, for I think a year or so, and then ended up coming back to Cincinnati. Brookville's only, you know, about an hour away, so it wasn't real far. But, you know, all my family's there, and just kind of like a homegrown kid. You know, I love it. And, you know, I went to, you know, my grandpa was a principal at a grade school. That's where I went to grade school, just like, you know, my dad did. Ended up going to the same high school that he went to. And, you know, just in Cincinnati, family and tradition is just really important to people. You know, like, it's kind of a weird place. You ask people in Cincinnati, like, hey, like, where'd you go to school? Like, they're not going to want you to say, you know, LSU, Tennessee, University. Like, they're asking where you went to high school. Like, where'd you go to high school?
Right.
So it's just tradition and family. It was always big for me growing up.
I just want to know if you got sent to the principal's office now.
Yeah, he wasn't principal when I was there, but trust me.
Oh,
my dad,
okay.
My dad was in there enough when my big John, my grandpa, was principal. My dad was a frequent flyer.
he said, look, man, if you have to come up in here, just know it's going to be twice as bad when you get home, I bet. Like,
it was a Catholic grade school too, and I think that's before, you know, some of the things now, and they had the, I mean, you messed up, man, they had the paddle, so I heard stories.
Oh man, so let's talk a little bit about that. You mentioned your grandfather and your dad and their role as far as athletes growing up, but you also have a brother, plays for Cincinnati.
Yeah.
Any other siblings?
No, just me and my brother, Nathan.
So, you know, obviously you guys are high level college athletes. I'm sure like the competitive nature growing up is probably super intense. So talk to me a little bit about having a brother that close in age and what it's like growing up. Is there fighting? Is there like a brotherhood, or is it a little bit of all of that?
Yeah, I think, I mean, brothers, whether that is, you know, a blood brother or a friend or a teammate, you're always going to have, you're going to butt heads at some point. If you love somebody enough, you're going to, you know, butt heads. But Nate and I mean, are kind of two peas in a pot, man. We get along great. He's my best friend. And, you know, I'm probably his best friend. And I couldn't ask for a better, you know, companion as far as that goes in life. And, you know, Nate always pushed me growing up. Nate is probably athleticism wise, the better athlete out of us. We're a lot different. I'm taller and way more, and he's, you know, I'm taller, way more, probably more powerful, and he's smaller, faster, more athletic. So it was always a balance between us. But really seeing Nate the last couple of years, you know, flourish into the athlete that he's becoming, and it's been pretty cool to watch. And, you know, I'm sure we'll get into it, but leaving Cincinnati was kind of tough because of him coming in as a freshman. Nate and I, age-wise, we just never got to play any sports together. So that was tough, I guess.
Even as a kid growing up, you guys were never on, like, the same team together?
No, Nate's 3 years younger than I am.
So at what point do you start playing baseball? Obviously, got to be super young, right?
Yeah, young. I think, you know, probably 4 years old, started T-ball. And I remember sitting in my backyard waiting for my dad to get off work and, you know, come home and just go throw with me. I remember just backyard. He's in his work clothes and collared shirt, khakis, and I'm in the backyard with my gloves telling him to throw me fly balls. And he was a pitcher, so he always, you know, tried to groom me to pitch, but I can never throw strikes. So I kind of picked up the bat and kind of went from there.
Looks like you made a good choice, because I saw some games against Gonzaga, and you can swing it a little bit. But when I picture, like, guys like you, you know, high-level Division I athletes, I think of, you know, as a T-ball player, you're probably crushing the ball off the tee. It just is probably super easy for you, and, like, you're just saying, hey, just move the tee and just throw it to me. Was that the case, or were you kind of like a late bloomer? Because we've had some guys that, you know, were saying that, you know, they didn't pick it up that fast, and it wasn't until a little bit later where they go, oh, now I'm figuring this out.
Yeah, I think, you know, growing up in a family that definitely valued sports tremendously and was competitive, and having a younger brother, I think competitiveness carried me, you know, in the early years of sports. You know, I played football, basketball, baseball. I played those three in high school as well. So, you know, I was kind of I just wanted to compete at the end of the day. I didn't really care what it was in, whether, you know, part of the reason I think I put so much value now in my life in academics is because of my parents, but also, like, everything to me kind of seemed like a competition. And I don't know if that's the healthiest way to go about it, but to me it was at that point. You know, I wanted to be, you know, the best at whatever I was doing. And for baseball, I think baseball just might have clicked, you know, easier than other sports for me. Probably just because it always was my favorite. You know, I was a good football player growing up. I was a good football player in high school, and I probably could have played in college, but baseball was always, like, that's what I wanted to do. And, you know, as far as coming easy, I feel like that's a tough sport to have come easier. I feel like it goes through ebbs and flows. You know, sometimes, you know, you're playing and you're like, man, I can't get out. Like, I feel great. And then other times you're like, man, I don't know what's going on. So, you know, baseball is a tough sport like that, but definitely growing up, it was something I excelled in and something that I knew that's what I wanted to pursue. So
Griffin, I tell you what, I'm reading a book right now. You said you don't know if it's the right way to go about it, but it says that men were created with this innate spirit to have competitive drive. I firmly believe that. Now, obviously, there's going past a line, but I think right. If you don't treat things with a competitive drive, that you don't try to excel, I believe you're doing it wrong. So I think you were doing it the right way.
Yeah, it's just like growing up. I mean, like I said, whether that was school or, you know, sports or something else, it's like, man, if I'm going to put time and effort into this, then I might as well be good at it. Like, what's the point of, you know, if I got to go to school and I have to go to practice or do this, like, why would I not, you know, try to be the best version of whatever, you know, it is that, you know, God's given me my talents. And at some point you probably get capped out. But my goal is, I think everybody kind of off topic on a rant here, but, you know, people ask a lot of times to define success. And honestly, I just think success is when you max out that talent you've been given. Like, if you can get to that point where you're like, I've become the best version of myself and whatever I'm trying to do at that moment, like, then I'd say that's success.
Yeah, I think along those lines, success is when you don't have to worry about the result.
Right.
You know, it's just, you know, you've given everything you've gotten and you're utilizing what you're given to the highest level. But I want to kind of go through those levels. Obviously, you end up playing for, you know, a young age, T-ball, coach pitch. You know, you probably play travel ball, you know. Then you eventually go to high school. What high school did you attend?
I went to LaSalle, De La Salle High School. in Cincinnati. So in Cincinnati, there's four all male big private high schools that are really, like athletic. I mean, athletically driven, academically driven schools. And that's where my dad went. And that was a tough choice for me, deciding on where I wanted to go. Because, I liked a lot of different schools. But I decided to go to LaSalle, and by far, one of the best decisions I ever made in my life. My best friends, I still talk to every day, I went to high school with. And early on, I was playing football, basketball, and baseball. Jumped right in, man. Loved it. Every bit of it, every sport. After my second year, my sophomore year, I decided to focus solely on baseball and football. I was a good basketball player, but I'm 6'2", can't jump. So I thought my resources might be better off in a different sport.
I bet you could play defense though.
I could rebound, I could take a charge, I'll tell you that.
So, throughout this journey in high school, I mean, just listen to some of these accolades. Perfect game, preseason All-American, honorable mention, second team, all league selection. You earned preseason All-State honors as a junior. You were also a standout quarterback at LaSalle. You were a three-time state champion. You were named Penn Station Athlete of the Month in October of 2017 and La Rosa's Athlete of the Week in October of 2017. So I got to ask you this. The one thing that really sticks out is you were a three-time state champion on the football field. Was there ever a possibility that you would just say, you know what, I'm going to play football instead of baseball?
I definitely, looking back, there was times where I had thought that. And looking back now, all I can think about is how thankful I should be that I had options. How many people pray for just something, and it's like I got to choose between the two sports that I loved. And I still miss football. There's just things about football that I miss. It was unique every day. Every game, every practice was different. Baseball is a craft of repetition, and football really wasn't. As a quarterback, the planning that went into it, I enjoyed that. And I think that's what made me successful at it when I played. But there was definitely thoughts in my head of going to play football. But looking back on it, I'm happy with the decision I made.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know what the prospects were or if there were any to do baseball and football at a school, but it just seems like at the Division One level, that's no longer a thing. Like it's
Yeah,
just.
I mean, I did have some interest in doing that from schools that wanted me to come play both. But to me, like I said, from when I was little to like the competitive nature of whatever I'm doing, I want to be the best at it. Like I didn't want to split my time between two things. Like I had split my time in high school between football and baseball, and I had been successful in both. But when I got to college, I really wanted to, jump in to being a sports specific athlete. I'd never been in my entire life. It's like, I didn't want to leave anything on the table. Like, how much better can I be if I dedicate my full self to this? And
Right.
that's, honestly, and like in high school, I mean, I was recruited and I went to a great Division One school out of high school, but I wasn't like a crazy big time, recruit out of high school. But when I got to college and I focused on, what I wanted to do, and I put, my time and effort into that, then, I got a lot better, and I got a lot better quickly with, and I didn't do that by myself, not at all, but with my coaching staff at Cincinnati, but I kind of blossomed, I felt like, when I got to college baseball.
Well, I mean, you clearly, obviously, the recipe for playing multiple sports prepped you with the foundation and probably more than just the foundation moving forward. But you killed it in baseball. You played club baseball for the Cincy Flames. You won the Top Gun World Series Championship, Summer Classic Championship. So, when you start throwing out championship and travel ball and just the level at which you're playing over the summer. At what point do you start getting recruited, or is that even a process? Do colleges just start throwing their name at you, or because you're a Cincinnati kid, like that was the only choice for you?
Yeah, I definitely, coming out of high school, wanted to go to Cincinnati. You know, both my parents played there. It, you know, it was a program that I would know I'd be comfortable in and somewhere I wanted to be. I think my recruiting really started picking up after my sophomore summer. I participated in like a futures games thing with Prep Baseball Report up in Indiana. And that kind of catapulted me. I had a good, you know, showcase type thing. And it kind of catapulted me onto a bunch of, you know, collegiate radars. And I had kind of been being recruited by Cincinnati at that point, but there was a different head coach there. And
what was the short list then? Like if that school start approaching you, obviously probably multiple, like lots of schools, like what was the short list where you go, all right, these are the ones that realistically, like, I'm going to, like, think about?
Yeah, it was really Cincinnati, Ohio State, and Michigan State when the short list came down to it. Those were, you know, the three schools that I wanted to play at. And when Cincinnati had a coaching change and a coach that I had heard great things about, who was also the head coach of one of my summer coaches that I was playing with, left Xavier and took the Cincinnati job. And then I think I committed to him, you know, within a couple of days of him getting that job.
So at that point, when you're going, all right, I got Michigan State, I got Ohio State, and I got Cincinnati. Did the conference and the size of the school or the prestige of the conference make a difference to you?
I don't think I looked too much into conference, honestly. I think after my visit at Cincinnati with, you know, Coach Guggins, who's there now, who was, you know, my head coach there when I was there, and my visit and how that went, and, you know, learning about the conference that Cincinnati was in, which was the American, which is a very, you know, slept on baseball conference throughout the country. You know, I know it's kind of breaking up now, or it will next year, but, you know, it was always top four, top five. It was, you know, beating out the Big Ten, beating out, you know, the Pac-12 some years. And, you know, once I saw that, hey, like, I can be in a place I want to be with a coaching staff that, you know, I want to play for in a city that, you know, I love. I mean, this is a no-brainer. So,
yeah,
it was a pretty easy decision for me, I feel like.
When you put in perspective like that, I think that, you know, when you go, well, why would you pick Cincinnati? I think just like you said, it's a no-brainer. You got the right coaching. You got close to home. You got familiarity. And, you know, as a kid growing up, I'm sure part of you, like, you
wanted to play there. Yeah, I was a Bearcats fan. Yeah, I was a Bearcats fan. Both my parents, you know, went there. And that's where, you know, I that was what I thought college was at that point. And, I something about that, too, is, you know, I knew that I had a lot of talent, but I knew I wasn't developed as much as I could be. So I really wanted to go somewhere I knew I could get better. And, you know, that coaching staff had a big track record at Xavier, you know, just the struggles that Xavier has to go through, being, you know, a smaller private school in the Big East. You got to get players that are, you know, you can't really get the big develop, you know, big time recruits that Tennessee and LSU can get out of high school. You got to get the kids that they missed and then make them good, you know, help them get better. And so I trusted that staff. And of everybody I've talked to, I mean, I will never, ever be able to talk highly enough of the job that those coaches did with me there.
You know, Griffin, talking to guys like you, you know, me and Daniel have talked about it. So my daughter, she's a junior in high school. She's a soccer player. She's getting recruited by colleges all across the country. And what you just said, everything you just said, has been so monumental. This show has helped me, and she's listened, and it's helped guide her because she's got the top tier programs, you know, offering, but we go watch them. And the reality is, even with the prestige of the program, will you touch the field for them? Or do you like that coach? You know, all those different things. So we watch these different mentalities, and it's like, go somewhere where you feel like you're going to like the coaching staff. Go somewhere where you feel like you're going to be comfortable. You know, one of the places we're going to go check out is in Daniel's backyard. You know, it's not D1, it's Division 2. But if you know anything about University of Tampa, their sports programs across the board are amazing. Yeah. And then it's Tampa, Florida. You know what I mean? So it's like, You find all the things that fit. It's and so you just said it. Like it doesn't, you know, people always think, I'm just gonna go to the most glamorous school on the list. That's not what you do. You find the fit.
No. Yeah, you gotta the fit's bigger. You know, everybody, you know, looks at a school and you know, a lot of times you're like, oh, they have a good football team, like, oh, everything else is great, right? And it's not always, you know, green grass and roses on that side. So finding a place that fits in where you can, you know, be comfortable. Because college sports are crazy, right? It's a massive adjustment, you know, getting to school, even though I moved 20 minutes down the road from where I grew up, a massive change for me, new change of scenery, how things are done, time commitments, class. Everybody forgets that you're now a college freshman, you're going to school. Like if you're not comfortable and happy where you're at, you can't perform, right? And everybody, every college athlete that comes out of high school wants to perform. They want to have good careers, you know, they want to be successful in school. They want to, you know, play professional sports if that's an avenue for them after college. But like they want to perform while they're there. And if you're not comfortable and happy, you can throw your performance out the door. It's not going to work. So, you know, for me, like I said, the fit was big. And once I got into the portal after, you know, last season, I had been through it. So now I understood that's what I was looking for. When I was in high school, I'm lucky I have two great parents that knew that. They understood that. So they kind of helped me through that. And when I got in the portal, I had learned that. So, you know, that really helped leeway my decision through a much, much more complicated decision for me than when I came out of high school.
Griffin, you're like bulletin board material that we're going to use for like these young athletes. Because you're even talking about listening to your parents. That's something these kids don't want to do.
That's the case my mom listens, man. I need some bounty.
Now you're lying. But anyway. So let's get into the baseball portion, man, because you already hit one point. I was going to ask what it was like, you know, the transition getting there, but you even said it, even though it was just down the road, you know, it was a transition. But, you know, freshman year, you played in 37 games, 26 of them you started. You helped lead Cincinnati to a AAC tournament title and NCAA regional in Corvallis. So, you know, first, let's start. You know, freshman year, one of the things we always like to ask guys, especially that have as much time in as you, what was the biggest thing that you learned playing college baseball at that level your freshman year?
Yeah, I think the biggest thing for me was learning how to adjust, learning how to, you know, manage my time, manage my schedule with class, because you know, I was taking a very, very hard, you know, undergraduate degree while I was there. And, you know, I learned how to balance, you know, my work and my life and baseball at the same time. And then on the field, I learned, you know, you think you know so much when you come out of high school, right? You're a good high school baseball player. And there's massive adjustments. If you find a hitter that a freshman that has a really good fall wherever he goes, I'd be surprised. I mean, it's tough. It doesn't matter where you're playing. It's an adjustment it's a different game. You know, I was blessed when I got there that there was a good core of older players that I think they probably realized, you know, that I could help them, you know, in the spring that year with my capabilities. So I think they kind of took me under their wing, you know, and helped me through some of those darker, tougher times when you're a freshman. And because, you know, everybody struggles, and that freshman fall is tough. It's tough. You start playing, you're scrimmaging, and things are moving a million miles an hour. That's why, in my opinion, I think the biggest jump that kids make in college baseball is between their first and second year. And that's why.
Absolutely. And we're going to talk about that. It happens with you, but you know, you talked about it, and you know, with baseball, it's such a game of failure. It's the reason why I didn't play it. I wasn't very good, Griffin, and I don't handle failure well. I was able to pick up basically any other kind of ball and do well. Baseball, no, I couldn't handle striking out at a little as a young kid. Like, so I was like, this sport ain't for me. I quit. I did 2 years of coach pitch, and I called it wraps. And so, you know, you got to be able to play baseball. You got to be able to handle, like you said, the you know, failure, the ups and downs and the roller coaster. And, you know, when you go to college ball at that level, you're going to have it. Everyone's going to have it. You know, very rarely do you have a guy that's just going to come in and he's going to rake or pitch well the whole way. But I want to get into, man, for you as a freshman, you get to go to the Corvallis Regional, man. Oregon State is obviously a big-time program. I guarantee you that place was obviously absolutely rocking. What was it like, man, to be able to go out there? Obviously, y'all didn't win, but just to be able to go to the postseason, go to the regional, be a part of that environment, how cool was that?
Yeah, that was awesome. I mean, Corvallis was a great place for that regional. And, of course, beating Oregon State on that opening game, who was defending national champions at that point, was great. For me, the biggest lessons I learned will never, be in a stat book there or anything, because when I started my first year in college, to start the season, I was kind of like a pinch hit role, like a DH here and there. And man, I couldn't buy a hit to start the year. I couldn't buy a hit. I mean, I'd come out there and lace four balls. And I mean, I was literally hitting everything I could possibly hit into somebody's glove. You would have thought I was trying to get out. And, and like you said, you're dealing with the failure, and I'm getting frustrated and, blah, blah, blah. And, I end up making a start at UConn on a Sunday. I get a Sunday start playing the infield, and my first at bat, I hit a homer, and then it's just the world was right again. So, things started flowing. I played, I think you said, the 20 or 30 something games in the middle of the year. And then towards the end, right before, the conference tournament that we end up winning, going to the regional, I'm struggling again. I'm a freshman and I'm struggling. And, I end up, becoming more of a back end pinch hitter guy again. So now, I'm sitting here as this, 19-year-old kid that felt like, I just helped carry us through our league play and put us set up for this conference tournament, and I don't get to play. Right. And in the moment, I'm sitting here and I'm frustrated and I'm mad and I feel like, all of these emotions. But the biggest thing I learned from winning the conference tournament and going to that regional was not on the field, man. It was how to be a good teammate and how to sit there and say, you know what, I'm not owed anything. Right. I played and I helped us win a lot of games. But you know what? If this guy that they're going to put in front of me is going to help us win games, which he did, then that's what's best for this team. And I sat there in the dugout and I became the biggest cheerleader I could be. And it just made me such a better teammate and such a better, just individual player, I think, because I've realized how to assess, those emotions and those frustrations and realize that, it's not about, you can't make baseball all about yourself. If you do, good luck, because it's going to suck. And once I learned, hey, and really just put my time and energy into the team and focus on that, and it made individual play so much easier, right? I didn't stress day-to-day stuff. I stress wins and losses. And when you stress wins and losses, and you really can truly say that I'm devoted to winning, then whatever your numbers say on that big scoreboard at the end of the year, I bet you they're where you want them to be.
Yeah, absolutely. And man, what you just said, like, I mean, that is, I mean, you're the epitome of what leadership is. And even as a freshman, like I'm thinking of a guy right now. I get to go to a lot of Ole Miss games because it's right down the road in Oxford. But Garrett Woods, the captain, replacing Tim Elko. He's got a guy in front of him that's a stud. So he has only started one of their, what, 11 games or whatever so far. But if you go to the games and you watch him, he's the guy that's standing there talking to everyone. He's motivated. He's completely engaged in the game. And then when he's gotten his opportunity, he actually that game he did extremely well. But to your point, like, you've got to stay involved with the team. Like you said, be that cheerleader, be that guy to lift other guys up. I mean, so I mean, I'm proud of you to say that as a freshman. That's guys that you usually see the guys do that as a senior, but for you to do it as a freshman, that's big time. Speaks to your character. Getting into the next season, obviously, man, we hate talking about this with every athlete. COVID hits. So I'm just going to ask you a simple question that I like to be able to ask. Some guys had access to facilities and were able to continue to grind and put in the work. Some, it was closed off for you. What was it like? Were you able to get to the facilities and continue to put in the work?
Yeah, I was lucky. I was. COVID was tough on everybody, and it kind of sucked for me because I was kind of having the renderings of the start of a really special season in my second year. I was playing really well, and then it kind of got shot down quick. But I was fortunate. I grew up and played with a kid at LaSalle who ended up going to Duke and then finished his career at my Miami in Ohio, whose dad owned a facility, a baseball training facility called Swing Time Baseball Academy. So if anybody in Cincinnati is listening, go check Shay out at Swing Time Baseball Academy. But he kept the doors open and he let me get my work in. And I know COVID was tough on a lot of people, but to me, having that time to really hone down and focus, I don't think people realize, you play fall ball, you play spring ball, you play summer ball, you play fall ball, you play spring ball, you play summer ball. There's no off season. But you know, they gave me four months to really focus on the things I needed to develop on, and it really set me up for the rest of my career.
Daniel, how many guys is that now who've actually have surprised us and said that same thing that he just said, that it gave them a chance to take a step back and get perspective? It's kind of amazing, Dan. I mean, he's got to be what, double digit now? It's surprising.
Yeah, I mean, when you think about the speed at which you enter college at that level, everything's moving fast, and just like Griffin, you were saying, man, like one day you got it, the next day you're totally like the opposite of where you were, and you almost start doubting what you can do. So then you go, let me take a step back, let me reflect on this, and let me just be a team guy. But I'm sure COVID, despite all the negative that went with that, you did get a chance to really just slow everything down and go back to like the fundamental basis and work. You had time to just work.
Yeah, and I did. I mean, you couldn't do anything else. So, me and my brother started a little backyard gym, anything we could do. And then we got into the facility once we were able to do that again. And then I just focused on my physicality, developing physically, and just honing into my crafts. And I know, numbers are numbers, but I was asked this the other day, so it's fresh in my mind. But my first few years in college, although albeit my second year, I only had 50 at bats. I had three home runs. I had two home runs my first year. So I had five home runs my first 2 years. And then I go to COVID where I can focus on, my physicality and the things I needed to develop on. And I hit 29 home runs my next 2 years. So yeah, you
You're
could
killing
say,
my stat drop that I got coming up, Griffin. My God.
You could say, you get better with age and you develop, you become more mature as a hitter, and that's agreed. But I also think that, if you say like, oh, what's the difference between this half is, I put in a bunch of work for 4 months when that's all I could do. And like I said, I'm not saying COVID, it was a good thing. It wasn't, but for me, it gave me time to jump back in and hit the floor and say, what do I need to do to get better? And I worked my tail off. I mean, I worked hard, and my brother and I worked hard, and it helped.
Yeah, and it showed, and you kind of talked about it, and so I'm going to get to it. So that, and you also talked about that first or second year jump, and that basically was it for you because your COVID season cut short. So basically, your junior year was obviously that first or second year jump, really. And you played in 52 games with 51 starts, batted 274 with a 362 on base percentage, but you totaled 61 RBIs, 11 doubles, two triples, and like you said, that power came in, that pop of 10 home runs, increase in stats, and started all year. So let me ask you this, because you talked about the work. Did you change any approach to the plate, or was it just the experience now?
I think experience helped mostly. I think as a freshman, sometimes, I get up there and you end up like you're just trying to do too much, man. You're trying to do too much, right? And you end up, you might guess here. I need to do. I want to do this. I want to do the first one. I just realized, just hey, like I can relax and just take my game planned approach that my coaches who do this for a living, help me make this approach, and then just go execute, man. And it takes a lot of the pressure off. And I'm just, instead of up there as a freshman and things are going so fast in your head, you're just up there now and you're just executing. And I'm an old man now, and I get up there, I'll be up there tomorrow or yesterday, and it's like, man, I could almost fall asleep in the box now. Not that it's not exciting, I don't enjoy it. It's just
Not
like,
now, you got 20 seconds, man.
yeah, now I gotta move way faster. But no, like I, it's just I'm calm, and I'm able to focus and execute, what I'm trying to do. And I think I understand what I'm trying to do now. I think a lot of 18-year-olds, when they step up there in college, don't even know what they're trying to do. So how can you execute a plan you don't have? So.
Would you say that it's, I mean, I hate to use the word easy, because this sport, it's not
Yeah, it's
easy.
never easy.
But like, I don't know the right word. I guess comfortable is the right word, but like, if there's just listening to you talk about you getting in the box and the journey to just getting to this point, it's like, I feel relaxed for you. It's crazy, but do you think the game has gotten easier for you?
I think I've gotten better at the game. I don't know if the game's ever gotten easier. I think I've gotten better at what I'm trying to do. And, you know, I think you get better through experience, in my opinion. I think you can get better in a lot of ways. But at the end of the day, you gotta rack up the numbers, because when you rack up those numbers, you know, you also fail, right? Mm-hmm. You're also failing. I mean, my junior year, I would have, you just said it, 270 something. So that means I'm failing, what, 73% of the time? Like, that's a lot of failure.
But this is a perfect segue, because I'm gonna go ahead and cut you right there, because we're gonna go ahead and jump that number. Let's get to when you start cooking with grease in the junior year. You went from 271 to you were hitting 315 with slashing with 382 and 695, and led the American Athletic Conference with 19 home runs, including homering in your first three games of the season against FGCU. So to what Daniel was saying, and to what you're saying, between the experience and the comfort, clearly, if you come out the season like that, you're filling in a place where you feel confident coming to that plate.
Yeah, definitely. Because I've been there, and I knew I was prepared. I knew what I needed to do to be successful, and I had had success to that point. So when I really realized, you know, there's a growth in college baseball. There's steps. There's boxes you have to check. There's freaks out there that have boxes checked before they get there. That wasn't
Dylan Cruz.
Yes. Dylan Cruz has had boxes checked when he stepped on campus. That's why he'll have the career that he's going to have. But for me, I needed to go through and check those boxes. So last year for me, it was, how do I put together a good season, a full season, right? I know what I'm doing. I know I'm going to have success. I know what I'm, you know, what I have to do, and I'm comfortable. Now, how do you put together a season? And I learned to look at it as a season. You know, so many guys stress day to day. Man, I was, you know, 3 for 4 today. It's a great day. Hit 3 hits and you're going to have 270 plate appearances. It's 3 hits. Just vice versa. If you're 0 for 4, it's 4 at bats, right? So I think mentally, that's what took me to the next level, is I learned how to think differently, right?
But even though you're thinking long-term, let me ask you, I mean, that opening series, hitting a home run every game in the opening series against FGCU, like, I mean, you've got to be feeling on cloud 9 though, right? Like, I mean, I know you think long-term, you've explained that you think big picture, but in that moment, man, I mean, you've got to be feeling like the man.
I mean, of course, opening weekend emotions are always higher, right? Everybody opening weekend, that's why, you know, some teams get beat, some teams don't. It's just different. It's almost like a fantasy baseball weekend. So yeah, I mean, of course I felt great, but you know, honestly, I can really say that I didn't get too high. Like I still stayed in my routines. I still did what I needed to do to be successful in practice, in the weight room, and, you know, in my routines. And I just tried to carry that to every at bat, and I wasn't perfect at it. And I feel like I'm doing a better job of it this year. And it's, you know, if every at bat I can be calm and approach that and execute at a high level for those 250, 300 at bats, whatever it is for a season, then I will, that's successful to me. Those numbers will be the numbers. Their average is an average for a reason, right? It goes up and down. Like,
but when you have the key is when you're batting over 300 and you're putting up the bombs, that's the key, right? Because you see a lot of guys, they'll hit 20 plus home runs, but then they're batting like 240. And for you, you hit 19 home runs and you're batting 315. So you're putting it all together. But you mentioned something in there that I was going to ask about. You talked about the weight room. A lot of guys are trying to, you know, especially because you're still a growing man, you're trying to get some size on. From that junior to senior year, were you able to, when you were putting that time in the weight room, were you able to establish, get you some size on you that helped get you that power and pop?
Honestly, it might have been a little vice versa, because I was transitioning to being in the outfield full time. I cut a little bit of weight. I was, you know, my junior year was probably 220-ish, and I cut down to, you know, around 210, 215. I think it just made me more explosive. Honestly, I don't think my physicality changed much between my junior and my senior year. I think, honestly, it was mindset and approach and mental game for me that kind of catapulted me to that next tier.
Yeah, so I mean, let's cut right to it. You know, we went through the Cincinnati journey, but our second largest fan base by the numbers is the Tennessee Volunteers. And so let's give the audience, you know, man, let's talk about it. They were so excited, like I said, they wanted you on. They knew you could rake. So we appreciate the way you killed it at Cincinnati, but and they're glad you know, you didn't choose Notre Dame, Arkansas, and Texas. And so with that, I gotta ask, you know, I was reading that and you're talking about three teams that were in Omaha last year. You know, was it the Tony V swag? Was it Chase Dolander's hair? What brought you to Knoxville?
You know, like I said, if you take my high school recruiting story that we talked about, you know, 10 minutes ago, that when I was in the portal, it's completely different. I was bombarded when I got in the portal. I was late to get in the portal. I waited till after the draft. And like negotiations for me and signing, in the spots that I, you know, had the opportunities to just wasn't the right fit, like we talked about for me. And it wasn't, you know, the life decisions I wanted to make to set me up for the rest of my life. So that's when I decided to, you know, go back to college and that I wanted to graduate transfer and, you know, experience something new, a new challenge so I can grow. And I got in the portal late and I mean, I got swamped. I was on vacation. The worst decision I ever made was getting in the portal while I was on vacation because I sat in my hotel room in Siesta Key, Florida on my phone for 3, 4 days of my
Couldn't even go
vacation.
hit the water,
I
man.
mean, I mean, I
It's
was
like
kidding. I was looking out the.
piranhas and sharks in the water, man. They
Yeah,
are
I was looking.
just eating.
I know. I hope it doesn't come off as, you know, pompous that I'm saying that, but you know, I just got slammed, and you know, I had put a lot of work in, and you know, I feel like I kind of deserved some of it, but when I came down to making decisions, I kind of had to hustle because it was August. Like it was, I mean, it was the end of July. Like
Let me ask you this. Were coaches at that point, like, are they putting pressure on you and to like make a decision? Or is there like, well, if you don't hurry up and commit to someone, they're just going to go to the next person?
For me, no, there wasn't that because like I said, you get in the portal after July 1st, you need a waiver. And Cincinnati was gracious, and I had built such a good relationship at that institution that they gave me the waiver. So technically, if Cincinnati didn't want me to leave, which I'm sure they probably didn't want me to leave, but I had built such a good relationship with them that they wanted what was best for me. And at that moment, I thought it was for me to transfer, and it has been. That was the right decision. So they gave me the waiver. So there wasn't really anybody else left in the portal. There's tons of kids, but you know, maybe with what I do well in the portal, I should rephrase. So I mean, I had a bunch of schools kind of bombarding me, but to me, it was the ones that kind of were on me, but gave me time. There was schools that were, you know, hammering, let's do this today. Let's get this done. And I was only in the portal start to finish for like 4 days. Like I wasn't in there very long, but the schools that did a good job of like staying on top, but also giving me some space to realize that, hey, this is a big decision. And, you know, there is a lot going into it besides your school. So that gave me that time. So I got back from Florida and I was in Cincinnati and I landed on a Friday. Saturday, I visited Kentucky on my way down to Knoxville. And I was in Knoxville Saturday, Sunday, and Monday I was supposed to, you know, fly out and I was going to go see Oklahoma State and Arkansas and Texas and, you know, some of these other schools I was looking at. And I just knew when I was in Knoxville that this was it. You know, and there was no, you know, Tony V swag. It's there. Trust me, it's a thing.
Well, hey, I was surprised. Look, because I'm an LSU fan, but when Tommy White sat here on this show and looked at me and told me that he was sitting on the couch with Tony V and he chose LSU, I couldn't believe it. I was like, man, because we've had Tony V on this show. We know what Tony V's like. And like you said, the swag stuff aside, but I actually picked his brain. I would have a lot of trouble telling Tony V no. And so when somebody tells me that, I can't believe it.
Yeah, he's a great head coach and he's a great recruiter and he's a very genuine person in general. And I think that's, you know, been a key to his success, honestly. You know, as a graduate transfer too at that point, like I could kind of see through the recruiting fluff of some schools that, you know, high schoolers I think sometimes get caught up in the stuff that really doesn't matter. But schools use it to recruit. So I was fortunate that I could kind of see through some of that fluff. And that's all I got from Tennessee was genuine people. And it's coaching staff that, just like Cincinnati, I fit in with, I wanted to play for, I knew it would make me better. And it was close to home. You know, it's 3.5-4 hours away from my home. So my family can come see me. My dad's been to almost every game. And I just fit in.
And that and you know baseball, and you know that pitching staff that you were going to be able to team up with. And so you've got to be thinking, this is a team that obviously can win a championship this year, because this is your one chance at it. Right. I mean, stuff like that sticks out. You know baseball, so you know these guys. You know where you
were. Yeah. And, you know, there's boxes that were for me that, you know, the schools that I ended up pursuing. You know, I had to tell a lot of schools, like, sorry, no, this isn't of interest to me. But the schools I end up with, I wanted to win now. Right? I don't have time. Like, my days are limited. I got the calendar on my wall behind me. They're every day I cross one off. They're going away. So I wanted to win in college now. And I had, like I said, I was very blessed and fortunate to have options of schools that will win this year. But this was just the best one, you know, for me. And it has been, and I've loved every second of it.
So when you get to Knoxville from Cincinnati, you know, you've now been in college for some years. And so you know what college life is like, you know what it's like, you know, being on a campus. But, you know, just how much different was Knoxville?
Honestly, I mean, it was a little different. It was, like I said, you know, I'm a grown man now in most aspects, but it's my first time being away from home outside of, you know, summer ball. When you go play collegiate summer ball, like, you know, I kind of did the freshman and 18-year-old college move away from home kind of thing. So it was an adjustment for me a little bit, but, you know, I'm a pretty mature kid and independent. So I feel like I picked it up quick, but at the same time, you know, coming to a city where I didn't know anybody, nothing, I'm coming late. Like I moved in, like I committed to Tennessee August 1st. I moved in the 15th. We started class the 23rd. I wasn't even enrolled in school till like the day before. Like I was going, because I'm in graduate school. So I'm going through all these hoops to get into school. But just how people treated me here and this program that you know, Coach Vitello has built here. It's just really, you know, as cliches as he says, Vitello does, cliches are cliches for a reason. It is a family atmosphere to the max. And it just took me in. I was comfortable and I was able to perform, and, you know, the rest is history.
So before we talk about the baseball at Cincinnati, I got to ask, man, tell me you took in some of those games at Neyland Stadium, specifically possibly Alabama.
Yeah, I did. I'll tell you what, man, I've enjoyed every second I could squeeze out, you know, of this year. To me, this is a free year that was given to me. I never redshirted. You know, it was the COVID year, right? It's house money at the casino. Like, how could I not enjoy every second of it, especially in a place like this? So, you know, I'm squeezing out every last ounce of things I can get, you know, out of this year for me. And it's been great, man. I took in the fall, I went to every football game, every single one that I could that was at home. Been to basketball games. I've done everything that I really can do in Knoxville. What I really try to do is not sit in my room. So, you know, I get out and go do stuff, and it's been great. It was a really hard decision for me, throughout the major league draft last year to decide what I wanted to do. But, you know, I just, like my mom said, you know, you just need to be happy. And I mean, I'm extremely happy with this choice.
I'm going to ask you a fun question because of the Tennessee Alabama thing. So we had Paul Skeens on here, and, so I was actually down there I went for the 2-for-1 special. They had a scrimmage against McNeese on Sunday, played Alabama that Saturday night. My guy came on this show and said he left at halftime because he needed to make sure he got his 8 hours sleep because he was pitching the next day. Now, you're not a pitcher, but would you leave the game if you had an early morning start the next day and you wanted to make sure you had good sleep, or are you riding that thing out? Whatever happens the next day, it's a scrimmage.
Tony B ain't crazy. He knows what he's doing after.
He would have never Alabama scheduled a scrimmage. Game. Jay Johnson.
You know what time we scrimmage on Sundays? Scrimmage at 6 p.m. on Sundays.
Oh, see, yeah, no, they started. Well, they had a doubleheader first of all, so that didn't help. But it's 11.
Fair.
I respect my man for going. He said he needed his 8 hours, but when I didn't know that, and so when he looks right across to me and tells me he left at halftime in that game, in which we won on the final play of the game, I'm like, Paul, you're kidding, right? And he's like, no, I went home and got my sleep. He said I saw it on Sports Center. I was like, oh, it hurt my heart.
Yeah, no, I'll tell you what. Chris Vitello, I think, is kind of the same. You know, he enjoys his life. He's, you know, he's built a great life and he's earned it for himself and he enjoys it. And, you know, he was down there on the field after Alabama, that Alabama game when Tennessee beat him down there with the, you know, on the field. So, you know, he does a great job of realizing, you know, what we do here is important. It's important to the community. You know, it's important to the university. It's important to him. It's how, I mean, it's how he gets his paycheck. And, but at the same time, he realizes that we're still kids and we still have experiences and he wants us to enjoy, you know, our life too. And he just does a beautiful job of making things work where, hey, you know, we're all here to play baseball. We all want to get better. We all want to be, you know, big leaguers and whatnot, but we also, you know, don't overlook what's in front of you kind of thing.
Yeah. Well, when we interviewed him, he talked about the importance of Tennessee as a school in general with sports. And he talked about how not only did he go to the different sporting events, but he encouraged the guys to go to the football, go to the basketball, go to the softball. Because, you know, as everybody build it up for everybody, because we want people to come support us in baseball. We want to go support them. And I love that about him because that should be true of every college. You should be going to all the sporting events, supporting the other athletes. I mean, that's what it's all about.
It was the same way at Cincinnati. I mean, we were always encouraged and, you know, sometimes pushed to go to other sporting events. And it's the same here. And, you know, it's experiences. And I feel like, you know, at this point, I have a different, you know, view on it. But sometimes I don't think people realize what's, you know, right in front of them, how special it is, you know, where they're at currently. They're always looking at what's next.
Right.
Well, you can look at what's next while also enjoying, you know, where you're at, because wherever you're at right now, and for me it's here, it's like I put a lot of stuff and time and effort and work into being here, and it's like if I keep looking at what's next, then when am I ever going to enjoy, you know, where I'm at? So and Coach Vitello is a big, you know, believer and facilitator of that.
Yeah, no doubt. So let's get into the baseball portion, man. You know, this year to start, you've played in 11 games. I believe, if I read it correctly, you've DH'd and played the outfield some. It hasn't been all outfield. Is that correct?
Yeah, I think I played most of those games in right. I DH'd the first day and then one day this past weekend. So mainly I've been playing right field. And then I had to sit out the first two games.
I wasn't going to do that to you. I wasn't going to do that to you. But, hey, our boy, if he was here, Randy was free, you know, Merritt on all over Twitter. Between that and Maui, I thought all my Tennessee friends were going to lose their mind. You had to sit out too, and then he.
Yeah, I mean, it was you know, dumb on my part, and you know, I was emotional and I cared. You know, I care. Like I said, I'm a competitor and I care about winning. And when I was at Cincinnati, and you know, my time there was done, I was emotional, and you know, I didn't control it the best, you know, way I should have, but. You know, I served my suspension and I moved on. It is what it is.
Yeah, you're good in our book, man. We don't hold none of that. So, you know, we talked about batting average, and obviously it's early, man, but you're batting 324, you know. Obviously had a big weekend. You know, you got three bombs now, 8 RBI. So, you know, do you feel like you're settling in nicely with this lineup?
Yeah, I think in general, you know, this team's figuring stuff out about itself, as every team is. You know, you want to figure it out before you get to conference play. And, you know, we're moving things around. And what's our best lineup? What's, you know, gives us the best chance to win? But, yeah, for me, it's been a pretty easy adjustment at the plate. You know, it's still baseball. I mean, hitters hit. And, you know, that's what I'm going to do.
I want to talk to you about one of your fellow guys in the outfield. I'm from rock throwing distance from DeSoto Central. It's where my daughter plays. It's where Kyle Booker came from. He started off the season slow. He's now done caught fire. You know, just how good has it been just seeing him, you know, as somebody who's a fellow outfielder, a teammate now, watching him, like you talked about at Cincinnati, right? Like when you had started slow, he started real slow, but now he's done started cooking, you know, how good is that to see?
Yeah. Kyle has all the talent in the world, and you know, I think that, like, you know, his first, I wasn't here, but his first 2 years, maybe it was a little underwhelming.
Well, that and, he had the guys in front of him were.
Yeah, it was a lot. Yeah, tough. But, you know, he's a great player. You know, he's a really good player. And, He did struggle at the beginning of the year, as you know, a lot of guys do. But you know what? What's going to make Kyle better is that he's learning how to work through those struggles, right? And he is learning that, hey, man, like bad days are part of the game, right? It doesn't, you don't need to freak out. Like you go have a bad day. It's a bad day. The sun will come up tomorrow. It's a new game. Go approach those at bats the same way and let the results take care of themselves. And you know, the struggles that he went through early in the year, are they going to be the last of the struggles? I hope so. Will they probably be? No. But now he's learning that he can get through them, and there's, you know, the sun comes up on the other side. And he's in a hot streak, and now you stay in this as long as you can. And then when, you know, it eventually tapers off, then you just get right back to work. And you know, I think he's learning, you know, those lessons now. Those and you only, like I said, the lessons you only get from firsthand, the experience. That's it.
So I got a question because I'm not too familiar with Cincinnati's baseball stadium and their seating and the way the crowd is. Has it been a major change? Because obviously everybody's all in on Tennessee baseball right now, and packing out, selling out the crowds right now. Has it been a major change as far as playing in front of a crowd and the excitement?
Yeah, I wouldn't say it's been, I mean, it's definitely different, but it's awesome. You know, it's something I embrace, and you know, I'm kind of like one of those players, and the lights turns on, and you know, the fans are in the stands, like that's what I want. That's probably the reason I came here, and it's great. And having a community so engaged in baseball, you know, the Southeastern Conference in general has good support for baseball, but I don't think people, you know, it's not like that everywhere. You know, Cincinnati had good support, but it's not what they have here. And you know, people are passionate about baseball, and you know, for better or worse, you know, a lot of the outcome of our games controls their mood. So,
And definitely in Knoxville, you said it, brother.
so you know, it's a lot of responsibility, but it's cool. Like, hey, like, you know, I get to influence somebody's day, and then you know, at the end of the game, win or lose, they're sitting there, you know, they want to talk to you, they want to interact with you, kids want autographs, people want pictures, and it's like, you know, it's important to them, and that, you know, that makes, you know, what we do on the field, you know, important to us. It's pretty cool.
Well, the first time I'm going to get to see you this year, you're going to be playing my team in Baton Rouge. I'm still going to need an autograph for that baseball collection you see for the guest
Yeah.
collection. So just because I'm wearing LSU, I'm going to need you to not duck me, my guy. All right? Like, because that just happens to be one of the first time I'm going to see you. So
Hey.
do that. Treat me like one of those little kids that's won that autograph.
Yeah, I will. Did you just keep me from, you know, getting hounded from everybody else?
I can't promise that
I
at all.
know
But
that's
dude, I
part of it
actually, but
too.
I'm going to tell you.
You see how he does you? He asks you to do something, but he won't do
But
anything in
no,
return. It's
I'll
not a two-way street, I guess. No,
no,
I'm
they name
saying
the
I'm going to
streets
tell you
after
this
him for sure, one way.
if anybody thinks that that's going to be completely purple and gold out there in that crowd, being that we have such a big Tennessee Twitter following, I know for a fact like 2,000 Tennessee people that bought tickets. So like that, so based upon numbers, statistically right there, right? That tells you 20% of that crowd's gonna at least be orange, and it's gonna be more. They're gonna buy up the ticket. So if anybody thinks that that stadium's gonna be all purple and gold, then they're wrong. So you're gonna have a lot of backup and support there, I promise you.
Yeah, that's going to be a good series, and you know, we're excited for that.
And so, missed my last question, and I'm gonna let turn you over to Daniel. Outside of the answers that everybody's going to say, like, Chase Dolander, Blake Burke, give me a guy like coming in that, wasn't maybe the big name that has surprised you. Somebody just, because, fans that listen to our show like hearing stuff like this, who's a guy that like you didn't maybe know much about and has just completely impressed you since you've been there?
Well, I think with, you know, how it is here right now, it's kind of a quote unquote star-studded kind of lineup kind of thing. So I think a lot of guys pulled a lot of, you know, past experience and success into it. But, you know, somebody that pops out to my mind, offensively right now, and he's coming on your show later. So here's a good, you know, I'm throwing you a layup right here. Charlie Taylor, you know, dude is the epitome of a great teammate, a hard worker, you know, somebody everybody loves him. He just does his work. You know, he's not selfish. You know, he just And he's a defensive first catcher, and he's very, very good behind the plate. Our pitching staff is phenomenal, and he takes care of them, and, you know, he works for them. But to see the strides that he's made with the bat since even when I met him in the fall, and how he's, you know, having some success at the plate, it's been great to see, man. It's been great. You know, catcher was, I think, a question mark coming into this year for Tennessee. You know, we were thinking about putting Dickey back there and converting here and there, but, you know, Charlie really stepped up and showed that, hey, like, I can be an elite backstop behind the plate, and I'm also, you know, in the lineup, I can, you know, bring some stuff to the table offensively. So Charlie's been great. And then I think just in general with our pitching staff, with so many new faces and old faces, the pitching staff is so deep and complete. It'd be hard to pinpoint one guy. But, you know, I'm thinking of three right now, but, you know, Zach Joyce and Seth Halverson coming back from injuries and working through that and seeing, you know, how much time and effort goes into rehabbing, you know, pitcher injuries and how well they're doing right now. It's just every time it makes you smile, man. And that's so much.
The Seth thing was hard for us. We actually had him on before the season last year, before he had gotten hurt, and we were excited and ready to see him play. And he was excited. You know, we talked to him about it, and then he got hurt and we never got to see him, but we knew what he had. So seeing him get to do that this year, we knew that a year before he told us about it. We obviously had saw what he'd done before he came there. So to actually get to see him get out there and do what we know he can do is awesome.
Yeah. And Zach's the same way. I think his brothers, you know, year last year kind of revitalized, you know, his career. Zach
is 105 miles an hour fast.
Yeah, I think so. Yeah, it's pretty hard. Zach throws pretty, pretty hard as well. So, you know, seeing those two guys get out on the mound and just have success is awesome, because, you know what sacrifice and work went in behind the scenes just to, you know, go put your cleats back in that rubber. It's a lot. It is. And, you know, 2 years of work to get out there and perform to help your team. So hats off to those guys, man. And trust me, in the outfield, I'll be putting everything I got on the line for those guys when they're on the mound.
So, Griffin, you know, before we, you know, get into our game, I got to bring this up because it's not often where we get guys on here that, you know, they're in the position to transfer out after they've already got their degree. So, you know, at Cincinnati, every year AAC, all academic team, every single year you were there, you get your bachelor's in biological science, and now working towards your master's in agricultural leadership, education, and communication. Was it important to you to pursue the master's and continue education and get the bachelor's degree and all that? Or, you know, like what is the drive there to continue, you know, with the schooling part, knowing that you had an extra year of eligibility, or you didn't have to use it at all? You could have went a different direction.
Yeah, so I got my degree, my biological sciences degree from Cincinnati, which for me was a pre-dental degree. Whenever my time with baseball is done, I'm already accepted to Ohio State dental school, and I'll be attending their dental program when, you know, baseball is finished for me, whenever that is. And, you know, so I really didn't need a different degree because I'd already been accepted to school. But so when I came to Tennessee, I wanted something, you know, I'd done my time with science, and I was going to, I'm still got to do, so I got to, you know, wrestle with it for 4 more years. So at some point, so, you know, I wanted something different that, hey, what's something that could benefit my career, you know, indirectly. That's a 1 year program. I want to get my degree while I'm there. I didn't want to do a 2 year master's because I don't think I'd finish it. So I settled on this master's I'm doing at Tennessee, and it's in that College of Agriculture, which doesn't have anything to do with dentistry, but the leadership and communications part of the master's is what mine's focused on. And man, I couldn't tell you how much it's going to help me, you know, in the future, as eventually, you know, hopefully I'm a dentist at some point or, some specialty of that. And when you're working, basically running your own business, understanding, you know, how to lead. It's not the same leadership in sports, isn't the same leadership in the business, or how to, you know, supervise, how to deal with employees, how to make people feel welcomed. And that's kind of what I'm learning here. And I'm proud I'll get to graduate, you know, probably in the summer. I'll have one class I'll finish up, and I'll get to carry that degree with me as well.
That's amazing. You know, you have options. I mean, you got dental school. You got this master's degree that, you know, is going to be kind of a secondary thing, but it's also going to help move you through that dental career once you're done with dental school. But then there's baseball too. I don't want to jump ahead, you know, and predict or anything. But is it important for you to be able to have the opportunity to play baseball after you're done with Tennessee? Or would say that, you know, no matter what, your career has been fulfilled and you can easily go on to the next chapter in your life?
Yeah, you know, that's kind of the decision I was wrestling with last year. I could have signed and, you know, started a professional career and played. And just like I said, you know, fit to me and situation is big. So when, you know, when my what I wanted and what teams wanted weren't the same, and I decided to go to school, you know, of course I wanted to play. I love this game, right? And I'd love to play this game for 20 more years. And, you know, that's it. That's my dream. But you know, that's just a bridge I'll cross when I get to it. You know, it's something that right now, you know, I it's hard to give an answer because I really don't know. I'll have to see, you know, when I get to that point again, put my options on the table and decide, you know, what I want to do. Of course I want to play, but you know, I also want to, you know, make sure I'm making the good life decisions.
I think you said it best earlier is you don't want to miss out on what's in front of you because you're
Right.
worried about what may be or what could be or what is, you know, months from now. So it's, you know, it takes a special person to be able to do that, especially with all the talents and all the opportunities that you have, you know, waiting for you. So whatever it is, man, it's going to be big no matter what, man. You're a
Appreciate
good
that.
guy. You're a good dude. And for the hour that we've spent here talking to you, man, like, I feel like I've become a better person. So.
Man, what I'm cutting promos. He thought I was kidding, man. I'm fixing to send it out to all these high school students that are trying to figure out where they want to go to college.
Well, hey, man, if I, like I said, you know, part of my role on this team too, you know, they joke and call me Grandpa on this team, but for the record, when you send out these promos, you know, I'm the fifth oldest. So, you know, Big Seth and some other guys you've probably talked to are older than me. But
Well, we had Luke Lipsius on last
he's way
fall
older than me
season,
now.
and I mean, I think he was as old as me and Daniel.
Yeah. But you know, part of that is, you know, I carry some experience and, you know, lessons in baseball and in life. And part of that is, you know, why I don't need to keep them to myself. You know, I want to help other people. I want to help my teammates grow through. You know, I want to help Kyle Booker grow through some of the struggles, you know, he went through a couple of weeks ago. And I think, you know, did I have an influence on him? I think did it, maybe not. But you know, if I can help, you know, anybody through, you know, decisions that I've went through, man, then trust me, reach out and I'd love to help.
It's a valuable asset having you on the team with all the experience and just wisdom that I'm sure that you offer. And you're big on the right now. So let's get to the right now, Griffin.
Do
Let's
it.
move on to our game, this or that. It's
All right.
very simple. You got a bachelor's degree. You're in gonna be headed to dental school at some point. So I feel like you can grasp the rules of this game very, very easily. I'm going to give you two options. You just choose one option or the other. Can't say both, can't say neither. Just be decisive and pick one.
Right. Is there a timer?
No,
Nah.
no timer. I mean, you know, if we feel like we need to put you on the clock, we will, but I mean, it is, you know, we'll have some fun with it. We're not going to
All
put you
right,
on the
let's hear
clock.
it.
All right. So originally we have a bunch of these questions. We've been doing this for 100 plus episodes. I mean, it's, you know, but every now and then we come across other questions, and you know, we've had the Savannah Bananas on, and they actually stole our little segment and made it their own, which is fine. So I decided we're going to steal some of their questions because they were good questions. So the first
Here.
few questions come from the Savannah Bananas. So first one is, would you rather be a teleporter or would you rather be able to use a time machine? Teleport or time machine?
Time machine.
Dude,
Where
he
would
was
you
fast
go?
on that.
Yeah, where would you go? I feel like you've given this thought.
Yeah, I think time machine would be the coolest. I think I'd go either back in time to a point where I wasn't alive for. Like I wouldn't go back and change anything. Or, I don't think I'd really want to go to the future too much. I'd like
What's like
to.
a decade you'd want to go to? Like the Roaring Twenties? Like where are you going?
Oh, man. Yeah, Roaring 20s doesn't sound too bad. I don't know. I honestly do like, I'm kind of not a history buff, but I do enjoy, history in general. I think I go back to, sometimes, mainly probably within the last 100 years, but definitely more I'd rather go back in time than in the future. And teleporting, man, I got enough going on with wherever, I'm at in that moment. I don't need, three different things in three different places.
I actually answered this question when I saw it. I said teleported, and I don't know if either of y'all have seen it, but the movie Jumper, where he's going from place to place, I want to do that. I just want to be able to jump wherever I want to go. But can you go wrong with a time machine?
Yeah,
No,
I don't mind driving, so
Yeah, but he's
either
going
are
to like
good.
Europe on the in the flash of a second. You ain't just driving to Europe, Griffin.
Yeah, that's true. Maybe I'll have to rethink that, but I'll stick with my answer.
So you only get one of these, and this is your only mode of transportation. So you have a donkey or a giraffe.
Donkey. I mean, where am I going to put a giraffe?
I thought about how hard it would be to get on and
On
off
the
of a
giraffe,
giraffe.
yeah. I mean, man, I don't want to be climbing up that thing. And I mean, let's hope I get a strong donkey because I ain't the smallest dude in the world. But yeah, I just don't, I'm not trying to feed that giraffe that much either.
I think it comes down to like what are you trying to like gain from this? Are you trying to be like, hey everybody, look at me? Like if so, like you're going giraffe. But if you're
Right.
like trying to
But
be
like, dude, it's
reasonable
I'm
and
trying to get
like
like A to B. I'm thinking like practical here. Like I need to go pick up Chick-fil-A down the road. Like I want to hop on the donkey and move.
You're not
And
going to get there
I'll get him
very
some waffle
fast.
fries and that'll hold him over for the next day.
Yeah, you're not going to get there very fast, but I think if you're going to get there at all, the donkey's the way to
Yeah, I think so too.
Would you rather be the strongest person in the world, or would you rather be able to fly?
Probably be able to fly. Like, I might not be the strongest in the world, but you can still be strong. But there is no secondary flying. Like you can still be strong and not the strongest, but fly or not fly is pretty black and white. So I'll take the fly.
Daniel, I think you know how I answered this question.
Yeah, you want to be the strongest.
You
Don't.
damn right. Stronger than everybody.
I mean, like at some point we're like, we get it, dude. You're strong.
Right. It's
Okay.
like, but can you fly?
Yeah, exactly.
Right. I can still, you can still be strong and fly.
I would go with fly. That'd just be badass to be able to
Yeah,
fly.
no, I think everybody would pick fly. I have an ego issue, Griffin, with lifting weights, so I want to be stronger than everybody.
That's fair. That's fair.
Jim said he wants to lift all the weights.
Man,
Yeah,
what? I
dude.
want 10 plates on each side. Let's go.
All right, so that's all the Savannah Banana questions. These next, battery of questions, these are ours. So get ready.
IoTV
They
questions. Let's hear.
ratchet up a little bit. All right. So what's your better uniform? The grays or your pinstripes?
Grays. Not even a question.
Not even a question.
Have you got to wear dark mode blacks yet?
No, because apparently a lot of guys from last year took the jerseys when they left, so we don't have enough of
Well,
them, which is really making me mad because I want to wear it.
what we've learned is that is against the rules. We learned that last week. You cannot take your jersey. I'm not calling anybody out by name,
Oh, well,
but
I don't know if they took them or they lost them or something. So I,
they probably lost them.
yeah, I think they lost.
Oh, what a shame. Would you rather go if you had the choice? Would you rather go to a bucket list concert or a bucket list sporting event?
Sporting event.
What sporting event is on the bucket list?
It's got to be a World Series for me. I've never, Cincinnati, man. I got my Reds hat on right here. Love them. Experienced one playoff game in Great American Ballpark in my time. We got beat by the Giants. So maybe take me back a big Reds World Series.
Is that when they had Aroldis Chapman and
yeah.
Trevor Bauer, or not Trevor Bauer?
Bauer wasn't there. It was like Chapman. They had Votto, Brandon Phillips, Zach Cozart, yeah. Scott Rowland.
So my question is, if you get this bucket list World Series, if you could pick who Cincinnati's opponent is, who you want to play?
I guess I have to pick an AL team. So probably the Yankees. Hate the Yankees.
Yeah, man, I said I want to beat the Yankees. All right.
Pete Rose, a Hall of Famer.
I think he should be. I mean, I think people have done worse and are in the Hall of Fame. But, you know, rules are rules. And, you know, just like guys lost jerseys and whatever. So, you know, rules are rules. So.
Absolutely. All right. Would you rather be attacked by a grizzly bear or a tiger? And when I say would you rather be attacked, you're not going to survive either one. But if you had the opportunity to try to survive, which one do you think you'd have the best chance?
What's the terrain?
Ooh, finally somebody asked something different. I like that.
So just to make it fair, we're going to put both in their elements. So a tiger in the jungle and a grizzly bear in the Kodiak.
Man.
You just showed your intelligence. No one's ever asked about the terrain.
I was thinking
that's important.
I was thinking, like, if there's some water, man, like, I think I could. Yeah, I don't know. Do tigers swim well? Like, I think I might have a shot. I don't know. Or I could hide for a little bit. But, man, I think I'd take my chances with the grizzly bear. Try to just zigzag. I think the tiger's too athletic, man. I think I'm both of them are killing.
Well, my two favorite answers in regards to the grizzly bear are Tennessee athletes. And Daniel, that last one, I'm still floored. First of all, Blake Burke said he'd lay there dead and play dead, which is funny.
They eat Blake Burke up, I'll tell you that.
And then we actually had Charlie Orsini from Tennessee softball on last episode, and this girl said she ran cross country, so. Not only did she say she would have more endurance and outlast this bear, but then somehow, as Randy picked up on, she said, because she said she'd outrun it and get away, but then she said she would get the bear honey, which would imply that after she escaped,
she'd
come back. Make sense.
She also said she would climb a tree, too.
And so. Bears also climb trees.
That's right.
That's what we let her know.
No, I think, I mean, I'd rather not mess with a tiger. I mean, it's kind of two evils, but I think if I had a chance, it would be against the bear.
Me and Daniel have been adamant about the tiger because of the night thing.
Yeah. Can you hit a baseball in the dark?
Yeah.
No, not a night game.
Not a night game, but like no lights at all. Like in the dark.
And you can't see the tiger either.
Correct. Exactly. And that's where they're their best, man. Is at night. It's there.
Yeah, no. Give me the bear, man. Let me.
Absolutely. I mean, plus.
I feel like endurance wise, too. Like, that bear is not going to have the same endurance as a tiger.
You might catch the grizzly bear, which hibernates 25% of the year, and just in its off season.
Might get lucky.
Tiger. There you go. All right. Last question. And this is a big question.
All right.
Would you rather betray your best friend? And I mean, like, this is the ultimate betrayal. Like, you can create whatever scenario. I'm not going to create it for you, but the ultimate betrayal, there's no coming back from this. Or would you rather go to jail for 5 years for a crime you didn't commit?
Jail for 5 years, crime I didn't commit. Not a question.
You are crazy. Crazy. Look, let me tell you, Griffin, let me tell you something. Jim is my best friend. And if you told me I could either betray him or go to jail for 5 years, I'm going to stick my knife so far in that dude's back. It ain't even going to be funny. Like, I won't even know that dude. I ain't spending
he said he ain't spending 5 minutes in jail for me.
I ain't even going into the parking lot.
I mean, yeah. We got 25 years of friendship under our belt. I can't even get like 5 days in jail, Daniel.
No, it's been real, man. It's good 25 years. You had a good run, man.
But you said it so quickly, Griffin, which tells me that you have a friend that you would basically die for if you're willing to do that.
Yeah, I got a best friend and outside of my brother. And I, man, if it came down to it and I got to do 5 years in the locker for to keep our relationship, I would.
Man, you're a better dude than me. I know what I'm good at, and being in jail, it's not it. That ain't for me.
Oh, yeah. I don't know if I'll come out in one piece or look any bit the same as I do, but you know, I'd have to try.
I mean, knowing you, you'd come out with a law degree. You'd have all
maybe
these
I come out. Maybe I come out ahead, man.
Yeah.
Fall in a bucket of crap, walk out in a brown suit. We'll see.
Hey, who knows? All right, Griffin, man, before you get out of here, anything you want to plug or promote?
No, I just want to say thanks to, you know, all the listeners and especially all the Tennessee listeners and, you know, the rest of the people that, you know, hopefully we get to interact with you guys and when we get to play you. So, no, I'm just super thankful and thanks to you guys for having me on. And it's, you know, been something I've enjoyed. And I look forward to signing that baseball for you there, Jim.
Yeah, before Daniel cuts you loose, man, I messaged these guys throughout. Seth told me, he said, yeah, Griffin's been swinging that thing lately. And then, and then Kyle Booker said you were the man. So these guys appreciate the shout outs.
Yeah, I love my teammates, man. And just want to thank everybody that helped me through my, you know, my decisions that's got me to this point in my career. And, you know, I couldn't be happier, you know, with where I'm at, and I'm taking it all in a great place. And I'm really excited to, you know, finish out this year, you know, how we should.
Well, outside of March 30th through April 2nd, Griffin, I'm rooting for y'all every single game. No, I love Tennessee baseball. I'll root for you. Other than that weekend, I got you, man. I hope you hit a home run every single game, go 4-for-4. But that weekend, man, if you got to hit the struggle bus, you know, I ain't going to be mad.
Backhanded compliment as I've ever heard.
Yeah, it's right there, right? Yeah,
I mean, you know, he ain't got to go up there and go 0-for-4 with 4 strikeouts, but, you know, if he wants to have a day full of ground outs, it's all good.
Hey, well, I'll tell you what, I'll try to do my best and we'll see what happens. So I really appreciate it, guys.
Do your best to ground out. I feel you. Okay. Thanks.
All right. I'll help you out and plug and promote some stuff for you. If you want to know what Griffin Merritt is doing on a Monday night, maybe he's recording a podcast, or a Tuesday night, maybe it's Taco Tuesday, or maybe it's this Tuesday and they got Boston College coming to town. Who knows? Head on over to Instagram at Griffin Merritt, or if you want to see what volunteer baseball is doing, what they got, all the details on the games, you want to see those hype videos, you name it, it's there. Go to at @ball_baseball. Griffin, man, we wish you nothing but the best, and we hope, you know, hey, maybe a magical season, maybe another trip to Omaha, and who knows, you might be hoisting up a national championship before it's all said and done.
Well, I really appreciate it, guys. Thank you.
Absolutely. That's Griffin Merritt, everybody. We're going to take a quick little break. When we come back, Jim, we got a lot of college baseball to unpack, man.